Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Let everything that have breath, praise ye the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We want to welcome you out to the Garden of Peace Family Worship Center. Amen. When we come to worship, hallelujah, amen, our Lord God. Amen. Hallelujah. We definitely want to open up in prayer. Amen. If you have a prayer request, drop it in the comments. Amen. But do we have any prayer requests here? Yes.
Harvey, my uncle Gary, and my family.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Woo, amen.
Any other prayer requests? Do we have any other prayer requests? We're definitely praying for healing. Amen. Amen. We're definitely praying for deliverance. We're definitely praying, amen, that God sets you free. Amen. From the bondage of whatever you're dealing with. Amen. We pray that God, hallelujah, does it for you on this week. And we believe that God has a word for you on today. Amen. We believe it's not by accident, hallelujah, but it's by divine assignment that you are here today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, let's bow our head and close our eyes. Precious Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord God, hallelujah, for just another day. Another day, Lord God, that you brought us here, Lord God. Another day to once again come and worship and praise your holy name, hallelujah, Lord God. We thank you in advance, Lord God, for your healing power, God. We thank you, Lord God, for healing, hallelujah, across this nation, Lord God. We thank we believe it by your stripes, Lord God. We are now healed, Lord God. Mental illness, Lord God, hallelujah, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. We rebuke that thing right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. You are the author and finisher of our faith. Hallelujah, Lord God. Lord God, we speak into the atmosphere, Lord God, that your will be done. Hallelujah, Lord God. And we thank you, hallelujah, Lord God. We thank you for doing it, Lord God. We thank you for carrying us, Lord God. We thank you for making a way out of no way, God. We thank you, hallelujah, Lord God, for strength, Lord God. We thank you for your almighty power, Lord God. We thank you for joy, Lord God. Hallelujah, Lord God. We thank you, hallelujah, Lord God, just for moving on our behalf, Lord God. We thank you for keeping us, Lord God. We thank you, hallelujah, Lord God, for strengthening us, Lord God. We thank you, hallelujah, Lord God. We thank you, hallelujah, Lord God. We can't thank you enough, Lord God. We ask you to touch, Lord God. Hallelujah. Shaw's family right now, Lord God. We thank you right now, Lord God, in advance, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Touch Carly right now, Lord God. You know the need, Lord God. We believe that by your stripes, hallelujah, she is now healed, Lord God. Do it now, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord God. Lord God, instruct the doctors. Give them wisdom right now in the name of Jesus. Lord God, we just thank you right now, Lord God. Touch Uncle Gary right now, Lord God. Continue to touch his body, Lord God. Continue to strengthen him, Lord God. Continue to use him, Lord God. Use those around him, Lord God, that are uplifting right now. In the name of Jesus, Lord God. Hallelujah. We come against fear, Lord God. Fear of the unknown, Lord God. Fear of what may be, Lord God. Right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. We just thank you right now, Lord God. Lord God, give those people traveling mercies, Lord God, that are on their way, Lord God. Traveling mercies over the highways and byways, Lord God. Encamp your angels around them right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. And we thank you, hallelujah, Lord God. Those that are viewing the broadcast right now, we believe, Lord God, that there is a word for them in the house, Lord God. Touch them. Send a word right now like never before, God. And we thank you today, God. We thank you and we bless you, Lord God. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Our scripture reading will be in Psalms 91. Amen. Hallelujah. Psalms 91. Oh, God, we thank you. God, we thank you. Psalms 91. Hallelujah, Psalms 91. When you get it, say amen. Psalms 91. Hallelujah. The Bible says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress. My God, in him will I trust. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Amen. I'm ready to raise a praise on this morning. Amen. Amen. I'm ready to raise a praise on this morning. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. How many ready to raise a praise on this morning? Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. 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 I'm ready to raise a praise on this morning. Amen. We're going to clap our hands. Is that okay?
Amen.
Is that okay?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Clap your hands. Hallelujah.
Clap your hands, all ye people, lift up praises, filled with joy. Begin to dance, come let us sing, our God is great, he is the King. You say, clap your hands, all ye people, lift up praises, filled with joy. Begin to dance, come let us sing,
unto his name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God, we thank you. We came to praise you on this morning now. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Get you some room. Hallelujah. Come on in.
Come on in. Praise the Lord.
I give myself away.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Excuse my seat.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. I must get that on today. Hallelujah. But hey, God is good and I find no fault in Him.
Yes, He is. Hallelujah.
God is good. Yes, He is. And I find no fault in Him. Glory to God. I find no fault in Him. Amen. 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 He is good. And as I said, I find no fault in Him.
Oh, my.
Amen. Wants us to live on top of the world, even though we go through. Amen. We want to live on top of the world. Because with God, all things are possible.
Amen.
Yes, you can do it. You can do it. You can go through it. You can make it through it. You can be blessed even in the midst of it. Hallelujah. The Lord is good. The Lord is good. And His Spirit is in this place. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. Yes, yes, yes. We thank you. Because we do come together to worship God, to fellowship with one another, and to worship our great God and give Him glory and praise. We set aside one day a week, 2 days a week, whatever it is, to come and fellowship with Him and our brothers and sisters. So we're thankful, amen, the garden here, to be here, amen. And I want to let you know that, you know, next time we're here, I believe it will be the first Sunday in June. I know a lot of people are celebrating today, Pentecost Sunday. We will celebrate it on that day, the first Sunday, and actually I think it is the first, June 1st. We will celebrate Pentecost Sunday, and that is the birthday of the Church of God. When the Holy Ghost fell, amen, and the first of those that were believers, amen, received the gift of the Holy Ghost, went out and preached. 3,000 souls were saved on that day. It was an awesome day, awesome day. God knew exactly when to do it, when all of the people were coming from all over the land to Jerusalem for it to worship. And that's when God said, that's when I'm going to pour out my spirit. Hallelujah. The Bible says that 3,000 souls were saved. And that's awesome. That's awesome. So, amen. And right before we get into the Word of God, we want to, we prayed at the beginning of some prayer, we want to continue to keep Bishop Riley in prayer. Amen. Our dear sister, Sister Cook. Amen. Also, our dear sister, Sister Wright. We want to keep them in prayer. Amen. As God continues to heal their bodies. Also, I know you said Sister Carly. We'll keep her in prayer as well. Others, I know there's an uncle that had a stroke. We want to keep him in prayer as well, you know, because prayer changes things.
Amen.
Prayer changes things. Don't let anybody tell you prayer doesn't change things, because I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for prayer.
Amen.
Hallelujah. My old Baptist mama, listen, you know, her praying for me, I know that had something to do with me, you know, getting into the army of the Lord. She didn't know maybe what I know now, but with what she had, what she knew, she prayed me back home a lot of nights that I almost didn't make it back home. And so I'm thankful for that. Thankful for that. Somebody was praying, and I understand that now. You know, once you have kids, you understand it. As they get older, you know, I remember my mother, you know, when you coming home and stuff like that, and I used to, you know, you know, what's the big deal, you know? But now that I've had kids, I understand. It's a big deal. You know, you wonder, where are they? What are they doing? Hopefully they're not in trouble. Hopefully, you know, they're not in the wrong place at the wrong time or anything like that. So I understand much better than I did as a teenager when I didn't even think about it. You know, I'd be somewhere and, yeah, you're gonna call? Nah, I ain't gonna call. You know, they know I'm all right, but that wasn't true. But amen, but she was praying. That's what I'm trying to tell you. She was praying all the while. Lord, get a hold of that young man. And that's what he did. At the age, I think my grandchildren here, they are, well, 14? Yeah, yeah. Not 14. But at the age of 16, going into 17, God got a hold to me. And I'm so glad He got me then. Amen. Because
because where would I be? You know, it's like that song said, I'm so glad that the Lord saved me. Where would I be if it hadn't been for Jesus? Where would I be? And that is so true, so true. And we have a generation to tell that Jesus is still the answer. I don't care how good you think you are, or how, you know, great you were raised and all these things, and Jesus is still the answer for the question that no parent, no uncle, no cousin, no auntie can answer, and that is, what do I do with sin? And all I can do is look back to Calvary and say, he took care of the sin question and said, now, all ye come unto me and be ye saved. You know, you that are heavy laden, you that are burdened down, you that are suffering, come to me and be saved. So, and it says, come, amen. That the bride says, come. You know, the Spirit says, come. And let him that will, let him come. And that's what we're saying to you. Amen. We're available to meet your needs if we can. Amen. And so if you want to come, join us. June 1st, we'll be back here in Peony Place. Amen. 1000 West Foothill Boulevard in the city of Claremont, California. We're going to have a great and awesome time in the Lord. So at this time, I'm going to go to the Word of the Lord. Won't be before you but 2-3 hours at tops. So, so just explain. Yeah, only 2 or 3 hours, maybe. You know, unless I lined up. But third chapter, 1 Corinthians chapter number 3. Amen. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. First Corinthians chapter 3 says, and I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto you were not able to bear it, neither are you yet now able, for you are yet carnal, meaning you are yet fleshly. Not spiritual people. He says, for you are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you envy and strife and divisions, are you not carnal and walk as men? For while one saith, I am Paul, I am of Paul, another, I am of Apollos, are you not carnal? Who then is Paul? Who is Apollos? But ministers by whom you believe, even as the Lord gave to every man. I have planted Apollos water, but God gave the increase. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth, but God that gives the increase. Now he that planteth and he that watereth are one, and every man shall receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building. According to the grace of God which is given unto me, as a wise master builder, I lay the foundation and another buildeth thereon. But let every man take heed how he builds on. For other foundation can no man lay than that that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. And I'm going to stop there. I'm going to stop there. Paul, you know, when you read in the book of Corinthians, whether it's 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians, you notice that Paul has to deal with quite a few issues, which
actually makes the book rich because of the fact that he has to deal with so many different things, because he's dealing with a church that came out of idolatry. You know, today we have people that come out of drugs, come out of, you know, gangs and things like this, and you know, as they get saved, they come out of a lot of stuff that is tough. And that's kind of how this church was. They came out of a lot of idolatry, and so things that they had done all of their lives, they were now being corrected, because even though their heart said they wanted to do right, many times they didn't do it correctly. Their heart was right, but they didn't do it correctly because they had not yet learned. Now, this is also after Paul had stayed with them for 3.5 years and taught them on a daily. He didn't just start the church and leave them. He started the church and then he stayed there for 3.5 years. Now, after he has left and he's on his missionary journeys again, he is now writing, because what they would do at that time would be there would be elders that they would have at the church, and they would go back and forth to different cities, and they would report to the apostles, if you please, what was going on at these different churches. And so that's how the apostles would write back and deal with several different issues that were going on in the churches. And so at the end, if you read the end of each book, a lot of times Paul will mention the people that are with him, the people that really have been back and forth, say to Corinth. Paul may have been in Ephesus, and they went to Corinth, and they found out what's going on there, and they would come back to him and let him know what was going on. Now, what he wanted to know was not the dirt. He did not want to know the gossip of what was going on. What he wanted to know was their state. Where were they in God? Where were they going? What could he add to them so that they may grow thereby? That's why they were reporting back to him, not so he could know who was sleeping with who or whatever or anything like that. He was not concerned so much with that as it was, where can I add something to their spiritual growth? And so as they have reported back to Paul and have told him what's going on in Corinth, the first thing that comes to his mind is people that do those things are carnal. Those are not spiritual people. When they have reported, when they have told him what is going, the divisions, the envyings, the things that are happening at the Corinth church, Paul now begins to write and to pin back and let them know, look, that's not godly. It's not godly to be jealous. It's not godly to be envious of your brother or your sister. It's not godly, amen, to put one up and not the other. Even as James said on one occasion, where he said that one person would come in goodly apparel and you would bring him to the front, and yet another person would come in, say, in raggedy or raggedy clothes, as we might say, and you put him in the back. They say you are a respecter of persons, and God is no respecter of persons. In other words, God loves everybody. Amen. From the guttermost to the uttermost. Amen. He loves us with an everlasting love. He reached down and got us out of the muck and the mire, out of a horrible pit, so that we could be saved. It didn't matter what kind of clothes we wore. It didn't matter, amen, what we looked like. God looked at us and said, I love you. Hallelujah. And I want you to be saved. I want you to be part of my kingdom. Hallelujah. Before I get too far away, let me give you my topic. My topic is, I'm in the family business. I'm in the family business. Because what it is that God, we are in the family of God. When you give your life to the Lord, you are in the family of God. This is why the Apostle Paul says right here, he says, for we are laborers together with God. Ye are God's husbandry. And every translation I looked at means you are God's field, he says. He says now, you are God's building. Hallelujah. In other words, we are, amen, part of the family. God does not do it on his own. He has people in the family that, amen, witness. People in the family that tell other people about him. Amen. I never forget the brother that witnessed to me. Amen. God didn't come down and speak to me face to face. Amen. He had a brother, amen, that was in my classroom that came back and told me about the Lord. Amen. He had someone else. I remember, amen, I usually don't tell that story that much anymore, but see, God was working on me because he had two people working on me. He had, of course, my brother Paul was working on me at school and witnessing to me and everything. Then he had a young lady that was on the bus, amen, that I saw her one day on the bus. I said, oh, she looked good. I said, let me go over here and rap, you know. And I went and sat next to her. And I said, how you doing, you know? And she was like, oh, okay, I'm doing all right. Do you know Jesus? I said, uh-oh. I said, let me get away from this sister. Yeah, like, do you know Jesus? You know. So immediately she stopped my rap all the way, you know. And but see, what was happening was God had an agenda. And he had people that were placed in his family that brought forth that agenda. Amen. They were not afraid, amen, to bring forth that agenda. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Now I'm going to get my notes. Oh, glory, glory. So, hallelujah, I am in the family business. When I, amen, was studying this, it made me think about, and I know more than us, I don't know about y'all, what y'all watch on TV, but it made me think about the Santa Claus, the movie, the Santa Claus, because when the boy was trying to tell everybody that his daddy was Santa Claus, of course, nobody believed him. You know, and they were like, oh. So his stepfather, amen, when he finally at the end realized that the dad, Tim Allen, was Santa Claus, he said, oh, you make a good psychologist, you know, which is what he was. But then the son said to him, said, no, I'm going into the family business, which meant he was going to be like his daddy, Santa Claus. So when I thought about that, amen, something, amen, he had an inheritance in the family business because we are part of God's family. We sing that song. We're part of God's family. Amen. And we are a family. And when we're envious and when we have strife and when we have these things that are in the church, amen, we should not do that. Amen. We are all working together for the same cause. And that cause is that I may help somebody to make the rapture, that I can help somebody come out of the woe that they are in, come out of the ungodliness that they are in. Ah, he saw me deep in sin, never to rise again. But yet God reached out and caught me. Hallelujah. And that is our job. Amen. That we might help somebody to make the rapture. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Help somebody to be saved. Amen. No matter what, amen, situation they may be in, we are here. Amen. Not as judgmental people. Not as somebody looking down at somebody else because of what they have endured or been through. Honey, we all came from somewhere. Hallelujah. Everybody has a past. And that's what it is. It's in the past. It's behind me. Amen. It's under my feet. I'm not going to keep bringing that up and keep, amen. See, that's the enemy. In the 12th chapter of Revelation, they said that the enemy is an accuser of the brethren. He is one that will accuse you daily. Look at what they're doing. Look at how they're looking. Look, amen. I mean, he is accusing us all the time. Amen. Trying to say we're not what we should be. Honey, I already know that. You don't have to accuse, amen, me before God. I know I'm not what I should be. I know I'm not what I want to be. But I thank God I'm not what I used to be. Hallelujah. Oh, you don't have to worry about it. I know where I come from. We know where we have been. Hallelujah. We know that God is able to save anybody. Hallelujah. Save you from the guttermost to the uttermost. Save you, amen, in a suite. Save you out on the homeless front. Amen. Unsheltered. They say now, unsheltered. So, I mean, God saves anybody. He can bring you from nothing and make you into something. Doesn't matter what you were before you got here. Hallelujah. Long as you come, long as you bring yourself to the house of God where God can save you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My thought today was, earth is our workshop. And it's filled with trials, challenges, and opposition, all of which are intended by God for our growth. Everything we go through, every trial, everything, every opposition, all of it is for our growth. All things work together for good to them that love God, the called according to his purpose. Hallelujah. You have been through some things. You have endured hardness as a good soldier. It is not in vain. Hallelujah. It is helping you. You are going to be able to help somebody. Amen. When somebody walks through that door and says, I'm going through this, and you can look them in the eyes and say, I've been through the same thing. It's just like being at AA, Alcoholics Anonymous, where the people stand up and they say, I'm an alcoholic. And then they begin to tell their story. And somebody comes through the door thinking they were all alone. But they find out that they're not alone anymore. There's somebody with the same issue I had. Hallelujah. I was an alcoholic. He was an alcoholic. She was an alcoholic. And that's the way it is in the house of God. And our brothers and sisters are all sitting here. I was a drug addict. I was a gang banger. I was out on the streets. I was unsheltered. I was homeless. I was down and out. I have been delivered by the power of God. I'm in the family business now. I'm out looking for people just like I used to look for people from the opposite gang. I'm out looking for people now that I can tell the story about how God brought me out, where he brought me from a long and a long way off. He brought me back. Hallelujah. Thank God, as I said earlier, for praying mothers, praying fathers, praying sisters, praying brothers. Somebody let them get in touch with God, because we were gone astray. We were, amen, going the wrong way. But somebody was on their knees. I don't know all that my mother had as far as Christian training, but I knew one thing. She could get in touch with God. She could talk to the Lord and say, Lord, save my child. Save my son. save my daughter. Bring them back from off the streets. Bring them from the gang. Bring them from the things that they're doing and all of the things they're getting into. She prayed and prayed and prayed until that day I came home and I woke her up that night like 2 o'clock in the morning. Said, Mama, I'm saved. I'll never forget the day I woke her up and I said, I'm saved now. I love the Lord. And she looked at me like I was crazy. Woo! 2 o'clock in the morning. She looked at me like I was crazy. She said, who you doing? You what? You what? And I was thanking God. I was thanking God. And I'm telling you, when you are a part of the family business, hallelujah. And immediately the devil tried to jump in that thing. I went back to revival. Went to revival, amen. That week, had my car. I had an 8-track. Now, I'll show you where we at now. In the 70s. I had an 8-track. I love that 8-track. I put those 8-tracks in. I had all my little groups, the spinners, and the Tavares, and all these old groups here. And I listen to my music and I go down the street and everything. And I parked my car right up there at the tent meeting. Amen. And when I came back to my car, my 8-track was gone. I just got saved. I just got saved and saved about 2 days. Came back to the car, my 8-track gone. But you see, when God changes you, see, that's why Paul told them they were carnal. Because, see, I knew I had been changed. Because when I got back in the car and saw that my 8-track was gone, I said, thank God. I said, that way I didn't have to throw away that stuff that I was listening to. I said, they already got it, so I can't do nothing. I can't listen to it now anyway. But that's the attitude change when the Holy Ghost came. Hallelujah. So all the opposition you've been through, all the trials you've been through, all the challenges you've been through, they were intended by God for your growth. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, my God. You know, some of us, that's why we say, ooh, I should be fully grown by now. Hallelujah. All I've been through. I'm telling you, the more he said... in the book of Exodus, chapter number 1, the Bible says something profound. It says that, and when they were in bondage and everything, it said the more they afflicted them, the more they multiplied and grew. Hallelujah. The more affliction that Egypt put on Israel, amen, the more they multiplied and grew. And I know they meant naturally. But what I'm talking about is spiritually. The more we can be afflicted, the more we multiply and grow. The more we witness, the more we tell the story, the more we come here together, praise and lift up our God. Hallelujah. Yes, when I come in that door, I come in praising God. I come in lifting him up. I come in praising and magnifying his name. Why? Because I've been through so much out there in that world. I've been trampled on. I've been talked about. I've been lied on. Amen. I have been through so much in that world that when I come to the house of God, I shed all that away, and all I want to do is see Jesus. All I want to do is feel his spirit in the house of God. All I want to do is, amen, get my dance on, get my shout on. All I want to do is lift up my voice and bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. I want to bless his holy name. Hallelujah. That makes you grow. It'll take you to the stratosphere of growth in God that you won't be envious no more. You're going to be part of the husbandry. You're going to be part of the field. You're going to be part of the workers together and laborers together with God so we can, amen, change this world. People trying to be political. People, amen, and I'm not saying you shouldn't. I'm just saying, amen, that our politics is on our knees. Our politics is witnessing for the Lord. Our politics is telling somebody about Jesus.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Telling somebody about the Lord. Hallelujah. We want to affect this world. We do it different. Hallelujah. We're not like the world. We don't have to get signs and everything like that. We, amen, affect this world. I heard the Lord when he said, I see the people out there. Amen. And I see the ones that are protesting on these different college campuses and things. But then I heard the Lord, I read the scripture the other day. I believe it's the 121st Psalm. He said, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. For all them that love thee shall prosper. Amen. I know what's going on. Yes, we're against atrocity. Yes, we're against genocide. Yes, we're against, amen, killing innocent people. But I want you to know that we are praying, hallelujah, for the end of the war. We're praying, hallelujah, for the peace of Jerusalem. We're praying because God told us to. He said, I'll bless them that bless you. Hallelujah. And I'll curse them that curse you. And all out of you, amen. And us being grafted in. He said, oh, because of God, because we are part of his family, we shall be blessed. And when people bless you, God blesses them. Hallelujah. When people curse you, God curses them because you're part of the family of God. Hallelujah. You're part of the family. Yes, that curse, of that blessing that God put on Abraham has come down through Abraham, grafted us in as now Abraham's children. According to Paul writing in the book of Galatians, he said we have been grafted in. Hallelujah. So that means that the promises that came through Abraham now have come on me. Hallelujah. And so if they bless me, God will bless them. If they curse me, God will curse them. Because I'm part of the family now. I'm in the family business. Hallelujah. And I want you to know that as long as I'm in the family business, I know that everything is going to be all right. Hallelujah. And I'm praising God. Hallelujah. Right now, I'm lifting up the name of the Lord because we have work to do. Hallelujah. We are workers together and the work is not finished. Amen. The fields are white. As Jesus said, he said, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. We have to get some laborers, and we got to get out in the field and share this glorious gospel with somebody else. It's not enough for us to come together and preach and teach to one another. We want to infect this world. We want to touch somebody's life. We want somebody to be delivered. Somebody to be set free. Somebody to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Somebody to go down in his name. We want change to happen. Hallelujah. Change to happen in somebody's life. Hallelujah. People to walk through those doors that have been through what we have been through. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I remember I did a service when I was at Greater Bethany. I did a service, a funeral service for a friend of ours, and her cousin had passed away. And I did that service, and you know, you never know how many people's going to show up. Mm-hmm. And when I got there, and God said and everything, there was over 2,000 people there, mostly gangsters. And I mean, you know, rowdy, you know, not church people. But you know what was crazy is that when I finished, did what I had to do, and we were walking out and everything, how you walked out, you know, with the body, and they put the body, of course, in the hearse, and then you walk to your cars. I ran into so many people, said, this was the church you were talking about. People I had witnessed to over the years. People I went to school with at Washington High. You know, hey, this is the church. Now I know where it's at. You know, I mean, because once I got saved, I was witnessing anything moving. If you was a fly, you was going to get a witness. You know, mosquito, hey, oh, don't you go nowhere. Let me talk to you. Talk to you about Jesus. You know, I mean, I was the one orthodox and all that. What I'm saying is that I remember that people started coming to me, and all these are like, you know, Hoovers and eight trays and all this stuff. And I'm thinking, man, you know, you never know what happens. You know, last story I'm gonna tell of Genesis is the last story I'm gonna tell. I had a good friend of mine. We witnessed to him. This happened to me twice. Might have happened more. I just don't know about it. But I had a good friend of mine. We witnessed to him. He came to Great Bethany, got saved, baptized. Yeah, I don't think he ever received the Holy Ghost. And about, you know, it came a couple of weeks and then he started sliding back. Didn't come. But in the midst of all that, he brought his sister to the church. She got saved, filled with the Holy Ghost. And about 2 or 3 weeks later, he got killed in an alley. And, you know, you're like, oh my God, what was that about? You know, I mean, we brought the brother here. Yeah, we know things happen, but Lord, we, you know. And I ended up doing his service. But his sister is still saved today. And that was, we were in high school. So you're talking about 1977. And his sister got saved like 77, 70, yeah. And she's still in the church today. Sometimes you witness to one person and you think that's the person. And that is actually the person that lets in the person. And I'm not saying God is partial. What I'm saying is that God has a plan. Yes. And his plan works. And a lot of times we get, you know, I would get discouraged. Like, oh man, I witnessed to that brother. It happened to me again. I witnessed to a young man. I was working at a shoe store. Witnessed to a young man. He came. He was a backslider already. He came to the church one time. One time he came to the church, said, oh man, yeah, it's gonna be my church. Went and told his sister. His sister got saved, her whole family got saved. That was Sister Rambo. Cynthia Rambo, who was one of the greatest, and I'm not just saying that, she was one of the greatest witnessers. She spoke in Spanish, she witnessed in Spanish, English, I mean, and her family saved. I mean, you never know the seed. He said, one plants, the other waters. But God gives the increase. That person you said, oh, well, maybe at your job, tell them about Jesus anyway. Invite them anyway. I know you have doubts. I know you have thoughts like, well, why should church? We're wrapping it up as far as time. Remember the scripture says in Luke, he says, when you see these things, he said, look up, for your redemption draws nigh. That's where we're at now. So there has to be a push now. We can't be afraid and timid, you know, like Paul told Timothy. He said, man, you can't be timid. He said, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind.
Amen.
See, and that word there, that Greek word that you, he said, God has not given us the spirit of timidity, being timid. Oh, I don't know. You know, oh, I don't, I'm scared to tell somebody. You know. Yeah, he told Timothy had been gifted. 1 Timothy tells you, Paul said, I laid my hands on you. You're gifted. Despise. I mean, he told him, he said, let no man despise your youth. You are gifted. Genesis, you are gifted. Jojo, you are gifted. Let no man despise the gifts you have. Because even in your youth, you're still gifted. Doesn't take away because you're young. I heard a girl, and I said I was closing, and I'm on my second close. I heard a girl yesterday singing at a wedding. This girl had to be about 4. She was singing like Whitney Houston. I said, I could be strong, gifted even at that age. And they said Whitney was like that. You know, when she was that age, she was already singing like greedy, all those kind of things. And that's also true in the house of God. You can't have people around you jealous, envious of you. You're moving faster than I am. How come the pastor put you up? How you just got here? We used to have people come in our church and they have a testimony. They get up, tell their testimony. People get saved and other people get mad. Mad about. This is all for the family. The family of God. So, as I close this time, I'm saying, like that song, play, give me that song. I'm gonna wrap up on that song. We are part of God's, yeah. I love you. I need you. We're all a part of God's body. See, I know the song. Don't be acting like I don't know. That's it. I'm closing with that song. Come on. Hallelujah. Come on, folks. We're part of God's family. God's body. Come on.
You need me. We're all a part of God's body. Stand with me. Agree with me. We're all a part of God's body. It is His will that every need be supplied.
Bye.
Greater Bethany Reunion. Greater Bethany Reunion is on September the 8th and 9th. I believe you can check with Growing Up in Greater Bethany. There's a Facebook page, and you can get that. I have it also on my page, but we just did a new flyer, and we're asking for all the Bethanites, young, old, all the Bethanites from former, amen. And guess what? We're going home. It's going to be held at the former Greater Bethany Elam Church now, but the former Greater Bethany Church, where we had church for what? I think they built that church. I was the second person married in that church, and they built it in 1979, I think. And I got married in 81. And but the church on the corner, amen, of 85th and Hoover Street, we will be there September the 8th, I believe it is, or the 9th, September 8th, 9th. It's 2 days. One day is a picnic, the next day is we're having a service, a reunion service. So come out. If you were a part of Greater Bethany, come out, be a part, and let's enjoy Jesus together. It's a reunion. Get to see. We want to see faces together without being at a funeral. Amen. We want to see you and have fun and talk and just really enjoy Jesus together. Amen. We are all getting older. A lot of us are going off the scene, so we want to do this and rejoice with one another and the camaraderie and fellowship we had there. Last but not least, I want to announce that on June the 15th is our Region 2 meeting. And that Region 2 will be at Bishop Lafayette Boyd's church, which is True Word Apostolic Church in San Bernardino. And amen, we will be there probably from about 11 to the night service starts at 3. So we will be there for one day only. It's our region, is it region 3? I think it's region 2. I got the flyer, but I don't have it in front of me. Next time, secretary, make sure I got that in front of me next time. Woo, Lord! Amen. So that's it for our announcements. Again, we're going to celebrate June 1st. June 1st, first Sunday in June, we're going to celebrate Pentecost Sunday. Bring somebody with you. You come and be blessed. At this time, may God richly bless you. It's our prayer. We love you. In Facebook land, may God richly bless you. Is our prayer.